Continuing my series on the writers of Star Trek, the original series, the focus today is on DC Fontana. Her full name is Dorothy Catherine Fontana, and she wrote under DC Fontana, so her work wouldn't be prejudged because she was a woman. A lot of early women science fiction writers did that as well, not so much because you couldn't get published if you were a woman who wrote science fiction, but because you wouldn't be taken seriously. As an extreme example, look up James Tiptree Jr. DC Fontana started working in Hollywood as a secretary, but she wrote scripts on the side, focusing mainly on Westerns. She actually published a Western novel in 1964 called Brazos River. She actually began working with Gene Roddenberry as a secretary before Star Trek, and Roddenberry encouraged her to pursue writing. When he went on to Star Trek, he had Fontana write the teleplay for the story of Charlie X, initially titled The Day Charlie Became God, which I talked about in the last video. And she was promoted from secretary to story editor in 1966 and had a big influence on scripts. She left the series as story editor at the end of the second season, but continued writing scripts for the show. After the original series ended, Fontana continued to be associated with the Star Trek franchise, being story editor and associate producer of the animated series, as well as on The Next Generation. She wrote scripts for Deep Space Nine, and she wrote a Star Trek novel, Vulcan's Glory. And speaking of Vulcans, there can be no doubt how influential Fontana was on the development of Spock and Vulcans. But we are going to look at the 7 episodes she is credited as the author in the original series. First is Tomorrow is Yesterday, which aired as episode 19 in season 1. I have to admit, I am not a great fan of time travel stories. I get annoyed about obvious paradoxes. And that's not to say I dislike all time travel stories. One of my favorite novels is John Varley's Millennium, which was turned into a movie. It's just time travel isn't what I usually gravitate to. In Tomorrow is Yesterday, the Enterprise travels back in time to the 1960s because they get too close to a black hole. They are accidentally spotted by an Air Force pilot, Captain John Christopher, and are responsible for destroying the pilot's plane. They beam the pilot on board, and Kirk decides he's going to have to stay and not return him to Earth because it would be too dangerous for someone with knowledge of the future to go back to the 1960s. But then it's discovered that the pilot is actually really important to Earth's history because he is the father of someone important who hasn't been born yet.
Wait a minute, I don't have a son.
You mean yet?
They also realize that there is a film of the Enterprise that has been taken by Captain John, and they have to steal the tape. It ends up that the Enterprise slingshots around the sun to gather enough energy to travel forward in time. And yes, it's the old slingshot maneuver, which we see several times in the Star Trek universe. Anyway, as they travel back and then forward in time, they're able to beam the captain and this other guy that they beamed aboard back to their normal time, and they don't realize anything has happened. Doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but hey. There are some things I do like about this episode. I like how Sulu gets to play a more prominent role. And I also love watching the reaction of the 1960s pilot to the future. And he says things like, "Oh my God, female crew members! Who would have thought?" And I'm sure that was DC Fontana kind of going poke, poke. And I have to admit, there's like little moments like that that were fun. And this concept gets cranked up to an 11 in one of my favorite Star Trek movies, The Voyage Home, when the crew travels to the 1980s. Now, speaking of Sulu, the next episode, season 1, episode 24, This Side of Paradise, was initially written as a Sulu story by Jerry Soule, but it was rewritten by Fontana, who was credited as the co-writer. And I'm kind of sad that Sulu didn't get his chance to be the main love interest, and I have to wonder if it's because Asian men weren't really considered love interests back then. But that said, I do really like this episode because it became a Spock episode and it really developed Spock's character. The Enterprise investigates a colony they think has been destroyed by radiation, but they find the colonists are alive. They have apparently been protected by flowers on the planet, which release spores that not only give its hosts super health, but also controls their minds, making anyone affected happy and filled with love. Spock is affected by the spores and finds he can return the love of a woman on the planet who he knew previously, a gorgeous botanist named Layla. In the end, Kirk breaks free of the spores because he can't bring himself to destroy the Enterprise. He discovers that violent emotions destroy the effects of the spores, so he goes about causing everyone to become angry or violent, starting with Spock, whose greater Vulcan strength almost kills Kirk. And Kirk has to use racism to get Spock angry, which is...
disloyal to the core. Rotten, like the rest of your subhuman race.
This is one of the more emotional episodes for me because of the breaking of Spock's Vulcan lack of emotion. And it also becomes very bittersweet because Spock admits in the end that this was the only time he was happy.
We haven't heard much from you about Omicron Seti 3, Mr. Spock.
I have little to say about it, Captain. Except that for the first time in my life, I was happy.
DC Fontana's next episode was season 2, episode 10's Journey to Babel. I love this story. We have never seen much about the Federation's politics, but here the Enterprise is ferrying a bunch of Starfleet diplomats to a conference on the planet Babel. This is the first time we are introduced to Sarek, Spock's Vulcan father, and Amanda, Spock's human mother. There is bad blood between Spock and his father because Sarek wanted Spock to go to the Vulcan Science Academy and not Starfleet. In fact, he doesn't even speak to his son, even though he's secretly proud of him. There is tension among the diplomats about a new planet joining the Federation, and one of the ambassadors is killed. So we get a murder mystery. All evidence points to Sarek as the killer, but we find out it couldn't have been him because he has a terminal illness, which he has been hiding. And McCoy can perform a surgery, but requires an experimental transfusion of Spock's blood. Now, Spock agrees to this, but then Kirk is stabbed and hospitalized. Spock feels he must continue as acting captain because the crisis among the diplomats is escalating. And, of course, they find out there's a spy on board and an alien ship is threatening them.
Come in.
Spock, you must turn command over to somebody else.
Mother, when I was commissioned, I took an oath to carry out responsibilities which were clearly and exactly specified.
Any competent officer can command this ship. Only you can give your father the blood transfusions that he needs to live.
Any competent officer can command this ship under normal circumstances. The circumstances are not normal. We are carrying over 100 valuable Federation passengers. We're being pursued by an alien ship. We are subject to possible attack. There has been murder and attempted murder on board. I cannot dismiss my duties.
Duty? Your duty is to your father.
I know. But this must take precedence.
In the end, Kirk pretends he is well enough to assume control so Spock can go back and do the surgery with his father. But Kirk, of course, ends up staying in command long enough to destroy the alien ship and uncover the spy who is an Orion disguised as an Andorian diplomat. Again, one of my favorite episodes because we get to learn about the Federation and we get to see a bunch of aliens who are part of the Federation, lots of political intrigue, a murder mystery, and learning a lot about Spock's backstory. There are lots of twists and turns, and the tension keeps mounting.
Well, what do you know? I finally got the last word.
The next DC Fontana episode is Season 2, Episode 11, Friday's Child, which is taken from an old poem that has a little rhyme about a child for each day of the week. And Friday's Child is full of woe. Now, I remember disliking this episode when I watched it when I was younger, and rewatching it, I can remember why. It's a hard episode to watch because the costumes are so spectacularly bad. I mean, they are probably the worst costume designs in the entire series, and that's saying a lot. I guess they were trying to go with some medieval theme, but the painfully bright colors paired with synthetic stretch fabric and fake fur make this episode just plain awful to watch. However, if you can look beyond the bad costumes, this is actually a really good episode in terms of story and plot. Now, DC Fontana wanted to write an episode with a strong woman who didn't want children. So she created Aline, who is the wife of the powerful leader of the planet Capella 4. Now, the society is male-dominated and very warlike, but they also have this strict code of honor and, I guess, chivalry, which justified the unfortunate futuristic medieval costume choices. Anyway, the Enterprise arrives on Capella 4 to negotiate a mining contract on behalf of the Federation. They also find the Klingons have an ambassador there as well, trying to do the same thing. The leader of the planet is leaning towards the Federation, but he's killed by a rival who is leaning towards the Klingons. So now we get to the dead leader's wife, Aline. She is pregnant, and when her husband dies, she knows that both she and her unborn child must die as well, so that there's no problem with the new leader, Mob, taking control.
Carry a child who would be Tyr.
I must die.
Aline is played by the great camp actress Julie Newmar, who you may know as Catwoman on the old Batman TV show. She is completely ready to just give up her life for the stability of her society. But then Kirk, Spock, and McCoy convince her to go escape with them when it becomes clear Mob and the Klingon aren't going to make life easy for them. This is a great McCoy episode. He is worried about Alene's pregnancy, and Alene makes it clear that she does not want this baby. And there is this slapping moment between them that's hilarious. And then Alene comes to respect McCoy and considers the baby his, McCoy's baby.
Say to yourself, the child is mine. The child is mine. It is mine.
Yeah, it's yours.
Out in orbit, Scotty is in command of the Enterprise, and the Klingons try to lure him away with false distress calls. And this is the episode where he says his famous line.
There's an old saying on Earth, Mr. Sulu. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me.
I know this saying. It was invented in Russia.
In the end, there is a showdown between the Klingons and the landing party. Alene once again shows what a badass she is by basically trying to sacrifice herself to save everyone else. I just love it.
Fight! Are you warriors or children?
Mob, I will flee. When the Klingon turns to fire, I'll...
In the end, the Klingons are defeated, Mab sacrifices himself instead of Alene, and they leave the planet with Alene in charge as the regent for her newborn son. There's a lot of questionably written women in the original series, but DC Fontana was the one writer that really bucked that trend. Speaking of which, this brings us to my favorite episode of the entire series, which may be a surprise to some people, but it is Season 3, Episode 2, The Enterprise Incident, with one of the great woman characters of Star Trek, the Romulan Commander. This is another episode about the politics of the Federation, only this time involving military secrets. The Romulans have developed a cloaking device, and Kirk and Spock are involved in a secret mission to steal the technology. The Enterprise goes into the neutral zone, apparently because Kirk is acting crazy, and Spock kills Kirk, but surprise, it was all a sham, so Kirk can disguise himself as a Romulan and sneak on board the Romulan flagship in order to steal the cloaking device. Now, the Romulan ship is run by the Romulan commander. We don't know her name. It's a secret. Can I just mention the irony here that DC Fontana had a female in charge of the Romulans, while Gene Roddenberry wouldn't allow a woman in command in the Federation in Turnabout Intruder, which I discussed about in the last video. Anyway, the Romulan commander thinks she's getting the Enterprise as a spoil of war and falls for Spock. Spock goes along with her seduction, but ultimately betrays her even after she tells him her secret name. Kirk steals the cloaking device and the Enterprise escapes. I don't know why I love this episode so much. Maybe because it's a Spock episode. Maybe it's because the Romulan commander is so kick-ass. Maybe it's because it's an episode involving espionage. Maybe it's all of it together, but it remains my favorite Star Trek episode ever. By the way, for Next Generation fans, the actress who played the Romulan commander, Joanne Linville, was asked to reprise her role in the episode Face of the Enemy with Deanna Troi disguising herself as a Romulan in another espionage episode. Unfortunately, the actress wasn't available, which is a shame because it would have been so awesome. DC Fontana also wrote That Which Survives, Season 3, Episode 17, which has another woman leader, an alien named Lucira, played by Lee Merriweather, with great eye makeup. The Enterprise travels to a planet that is an anomaly. It is too young of a planet to have the biology and atmosphere that exists on it. The landing party includes Kirk, McCoy, Sulu, and a geologist who may as well be wearing a red shirt. It is so obvious that its only purpose is to die. Anyway, as soon as the landing party teleports to the planet, a mysterious woman arrives in the transporter chamber on board the Enterprise and kills the transporter chief. The Enterprise is then flung 990 light years away. On the planet, the away team is stranded, and the mystery woman appears and kills the geologist. Surprise, surprise. One thing I thought was funny was that the doctor second in command back on the Enterprise took forever to determine that the transporter chief was killed by cellular disruption. But McCoy just takes one reading on his medical scanner and in seconds determines the cause of death.
Body's been disrupted.
Anyway, the mystery woman is actually some sort of hologram that a computer on the planet generates. Each hologram is programmed to kill just one person as part of some self-defense measure. In the end, they find out that she is the image of Lucira, the commander of an alien race, the last survivor of some sort of terraforming expedition that died out thousands of years ago. Now, it's an okay episode, very middle of the road for me. The best thing about it is, yeah, Lucira's costume and eye makeup. Okay, the last DC Fontana episode was co-written with Arthur Heinemann, Season 3, Episode 20, The Way to Eden. This episode is infamous among Star Trek fans and is nicknamed the Space Hippie episode. Just say Space Hippies and any Star Trek fan will immediately know what you are talking about. The Enterprise picks up the crew of a stolen spaceship, which is run by Dr. Severin, who is the cult leader of a group of 20-something hippies. And they are trying to find the lost planet of Eden, which is supposed to be some sort of paradise. And this is a Chekhov episode, as he used to date one of the space hippies. Now, Spock is the only one really sympathetic to the space hippies. Anyway, Dr. Severin and his followers demand to be taken to Eden, but Kirk is taking them to a starbase instead. So the space hippies devise a plot to hijack the Enterprise, and they eventually make it to Eden, which proves to be a beautiful and perfect planet, except everything is toxic and will kill you. Severin, of course, dies trying to eat one of the forbidden fruits. Why this episode doesn't work, at least what makes it so funny, because it is so unintentionally camp, is the premise relies on the fact that the space hippies are so cool that they are able to seduce the Enterprise crew into giving them valuable information.
Yes, think. I'm standing here wondering.
What?
Part of this involves their groovy music. Music so powerful that the crew just jams away when they hear the music. Even Sulu. Unfortunately, the music is in reality so bad and cringy that it makes you either laugh or cover your ears. The absolute best part, of course, is when Spock joins the space hippies in a jam session, which is worth the price of admission. Anyway, I think objectively, this is Fontana's weakest episode. Its only redemption is the fact that it is so camp that it's amusing to watch. But obviously, that wasn't the intention of the writers. Maybe if they actually had good music, I don't know. So that concludes the episodes where DC Fontana is credited as the writer. Of course, as story editor, she did much more in influencing the teleplays. Without a doubt, she is the first lady of the Star Trek universe and should be so honored by anyone who calls himself a Star Trek fan. Please give this video a like, and if you want to see more on Star Trek writers, please subscribe if you are not already. Until we meet again, live long and prosper, and may all the books you read be blessed.